Welcome to the Pulse of St. Louis. I'm Shirley Washington. Tonight, we take a closer look at some amazing educational programs offered to high school students in the Gateway City area. The Missouri Court of Appeals Eastern Division Docket was recently held at Fort Zumwalt West High School. I know, right? Instead of the courthouse. Yes. Joining me now, Lisa Page. She is the Chief Judge of the Missouri Court of Appeals Eastern District. Christine Bertelson, she is Director of Communications for the 21st Judicial Circuit. Doug Gaston, Associate Circuit Judge for the 25th Circuit Court and founder of the Constitution Project. And finally, Ted House, Circuit Judge, Chairperson of the Supreme Court of Civic Education Committee. Thank you all so much for being here. I appreciate it.
Thank you. I'm really curious
about the court actually going into a high school. How did that happen and why did it happen, Judge Page?
Well, the Eastern District is able to take our show on the road. And we have dockets, traditionally a Southern Docket down in Cape Girardeau, which is sometimes held at the university. This year it's going to be held in Central High School in Cape Girardeau. I believe that's going to be in, actually on Halloween, if I'm not mistaken.
Really?
Yes.
And it's no joke. It's Halloween.
It's no joke. I don't joke about Clark.
I hear you.
But no, and so, and then we have a Northern, traditionally a Northern Docket that's held in Hannibal. And I don't know that we've set the exact location for that docket. I think that's in November. Mm-hmm. And so we were short a judge due to the retirement of Judge Lisa Van Amberg. And so the idea came to me to expand take the cases out into the communities more so that we could have a special judge, such as Judge House, sit in place of our judge who we're missing until the Missouri plan fills Judge Van Amberg's vacancy sometime early next year. So then, actually, the real idea became this idea to showcase the Supreme Court Civic Education Committee's programs. So before we began oral argument at Fort Zumwalt West, Judge House gave the Hazelwood versus Kohlmeier presentation, and the students were just intrigued. And I gotta tell you, it's pretty impressive to intrigue a room of about 500 kids.
Absolutely. Teenagers, no doubt.
Exactly.
Judge House, fill me in. Tell me, what's the mission? Why do this?
The Supreme Court of Missouri, Shirley, has created the Civic Education Committee in order to help educate citizens of Missouri about what we do as judges. You know, what is the judiciary about? How's it formed? What process do we use? What are the standards that we use? And we want to go out into the communities and help people understand the vital importance of a fair and impartial judiciary across the state. The role of the judiciary is an independent branch of state government. And the key of the Civic Education Initiative is to get judges out into classrooms across Missouri, civic organizations, churches and schools and senior citizen centers and religious organizations and anybody who would like to have a judge come and share information about how the court functions and what we do. We're eager to do that. So we want to thank you for the opportunity to be here today to help spread that word.
And thank you for being here. Why is this program so unique?
Well, judges want to get out into the community. And I think a lot of folks look at judges and they think we're sort of, you know, isolated or detached, you know, and in fact, we have judges all across the state who want to get out into schools and civic organizations and meet people, relate what we do, help folks understand how the judicial system works. You know, as a journalist, you know, I mean, every time there's a high-profile case, people ask questions about, well, how does the judicial system really, really function? You know, we want to have that conversation with citizens of Missouri of all ages and help people understand the judiciary because it's vital to our democracy.
Absolutely. Judge Gaston, give us a sense of how does the judicial system work and why is it important that we understand that?
Well, of course, it's one of the three branches of government and a critical one to make sure that the Constitution is upheld for one thing in all respects, but also that everyone's rights are protected day in and day out in every possible way. And so it's really important that everyone understand that mission and support that mission.
Ms. Bertelson, give me a sense of who's invited to these events. I mean, is this something that the public can attend as well in addition to students and staff and teachers?
Absolutely. We really welcome the opportunity to talk to any group and would love to have the public get in touch with any of the judges or contact me. I'm specifically assigned to the St. Louis County Circuit Court, but we are the largest circuit and the busiest circuit in the state of Missouri. So we cover a big area. We have lots of school districts, lots of community groups, advocacy groups, citizen groups, And anytime they contact me, we're happy to send judges out to make a presentation. So all you have to do is ask and we'll be there.
All right, sounds good.
And Shirley, I wanted to mention one thing. You know, one of the sort of catch-22 situations for the judges is that they are not allowed to comment on cases that are before them or comment on cases that are in the public eye. They can't talk about, you know, they can't really weigh in. They're ethically bound to keep their distance from that. So sort of like, well, how do you get that out there and talk, and what do you talk about, and when can't you talk? So I think we use these presentations as a great wedge to get out and get into the public eye and talk about issues that people care about, not specific to a certain case, but about how the judiciary works and how it works for the citizens of our state.
And you're absolutely right, because being a journalist, I have actually had the opportunity to put in a request or inquiry to a judge, and it always comes back, sorry, no comment. So I get that. You're absolutely right. And a lot of times when those cases are over, we will hear word from the court, and usually the judge will say something at the end of a case. Right. So I totally get that. So Judge Page, given that fact, give me a sense of what happens when you actually take these courts into the high schools. These are real cases.
They are.
So tell me what happened at Fort Zumwalt West.
Well, we had two cases. They were both criminal cases. So the public defender was appealing the trial court in each case, and the state of Missouri was represented by the Missouri Attorney General's office. These are some of the most experienced appellate attorneys, because they do so much appellate work for the public defender's office and for the state of Missouri, that as a court, we decided that those might be the best people who would be comfortable being thrown in front of 500 students to do their oral arguments on behalf of their clients. Wow. Outside of the courtroom. Because at the courtroom, there may be 10 people in the entire courtroom. And there were, what, close to 500 students, Judge House?
There were.
He felt that acutely.
The students were wonderful. Their teachers and staff had done a great job of giving them information about the cases so that they could study that in advance. They knew some of the legal terminology. They knew the facts of the cases. And, I mean, the students at Fort Zumwalt West High School were amazing. They were engaged and interested in what the Court of Appeals was doing. And I was very impressed with the with the students. Not that I'm surprised,
right,
you know.
Right, right.
But I wasn't sure, you know, we give a lot of these civic education presentations. I'd never given one to 500 students
before. No, I don't think I ever have either.
So I wasn't sure how engaging the students would be, but they were marvelous. They really
is it different? Does it feel different being in the high school as opposed to being in the courtroom?
Well, it's a very different environment. there's no doubt about that. These students understood that this case was real.
Right.
Know, what when Judge Page brought the Court of Appeals to Fort Zumwalt West High School, I mean, they knew that this isn't pretend, this isn't a mock trial. This is real people's lives, a lot at stake. And they responded to that and respected that very much. So, but it's an entirely different dynamic, of course, when you're, you know, as judges, we're used to being in our courtroom, and like anything, you know, you kind of get comfortable
with
that.
Right.
And
right.
When you're in it, when you're in a different venue or environment, it's a different feel.
And a lot of eyes on you too.
Well, that's true. That's true. But you know, we always welcome. You know, our courts are always open to the public. But I appreciate.
They don't usually show up 500 at a time. I think.
Well, I appreciated that. You know, I'm a trial judge in St. Charles County, but I appreciated the Court of Appeals, Judge Page, doing what you're doing, bringing this out to the community, because the appellate process is just as important and just as fascinating as jury trials. Because that's a critical part of the process as well. So these students got to see that appellate process in action in real life cases, and I was so impressed with their response to it and their ability to the wisdom and insight that they showed in understanding what we were doing.
So give us a sense of what exactly the appellate court does for the viewers who may not know, because as Judge House says, if there's a jury trial and there is a decision at the jury trial, we hear all the time, we're going to appeal the decision. So give us a sense, Judge Page, of what is involved in all that. What exactly does that mean?
Well, I think the easiest way to describe it is I explained it to my octogenarian aunties when they asked me the question, what do you do now?
Right.
They understood trial judge. Right. They understand Supreme Court. They call me the middle court.
Okay.
So, but
okay.
But basically, it's we grade the trial judge's homework. Did they do it right? We don't really look at what the finder of fact decides. We don't look at, we defer to, greatly to the jury, but we look at the different rulings the judge makes. We look at the, and just to make sure that we believe the trial was fair. And so, and I was curious how you felt being grading the homework as opposed to being the one turning the homework in Judge House.
It's a different role to have a special appointment to join the Court of Appeals, because I'm the trial judge. I'm usually the one who's thinking in advance what the right. Court of Appeals is going to think about the rulings that I'm making. So it's a different feel.
Judge House, give me a sense. That's interesting that you said that. So how do you go about making your ruling?
Every case is different. Mm-hmm. You know, we take an oath, as Judge Gaston said, to abide by the Constitution of the United States of America and the state of Missouri. We follow the law of the state. And we are bound by the evidence that is in the courtroom. And one of several of our civic education presentations go to that very fact that sometimes judges have to make unpopular decisions. And that's part of the independence of the judicial branch of government. It's why it's so vital to our democracy for us to be fair and impartial, is that we know that sometimes we're controlled by the law of the state and the evidence in our case, and we know that sometimes that could be misunderstood by folks or could just be an unpopular decision, but we have to do what we know is right according to the law and the evidence. And so part of our civic education presentations help the public understand, well, why something that may seem strange or awkward on the, you know, the face of it, why would a judge do that? And there's explanations for that. So that's part of what we try to do.
Awesome. Got to take a break. Stay with us. We are back in a moment. And when we come back, we're going to tell you about a unique way students are learning about the Constitution. Stay with us back in a moment. Welcome back to the Pulse of St. Louis. We are talking about unique programs. Local appellate court judges are offering high school students in the Gateway City area. And we started the conversation talking about the Docket program. Now we want to tell you a little bit about another program called the Constitution Project. So Judge Gaston, give me a sense of the Constitution program. What is that one about?
It is a way that we involve students in a very hands-on way to learn about their country, to learn about the court system, to get experience in different professions. The three professions in the project are journalism, trial advocacy, being an attorney, and police work. And so along the way, we have these students link up with mentors in their community, and they have a very experience-driven, hands-on practice from the beginning of the competition all the way through the finals. And they do the job of these professionals, and they get scored by professional judges, scorers who go out into the communities and watch them perform and give them scores on how well they do.
So give me a sense, are they presented with a case and then they have to go out and investigate, and then they're also being reporters as well? Tell me exactly what goes on.
So essentially, right now we have kicked off the project. Right now all the schools are practicing. Regionals will start in a couple of weeks, and when they show up to regionals, the crime scene team will pull up in a police vehicle with the lights and sirens going, and the crime scene will be there for them. And we've done murder scenes, car wrecks, kidnappings, all kinds of crazy things that we throw at these kids, and they're expected then to get out and handle their job just like the law enforcement officer would. Make arrests, interview witnesses, gather evidence, do fingerprints, all those things that a police officer would do. The journalists come about 10 minutes into that, and then they try to find out what they can find out within the confines of the crime scene, and their teammates are making sure they stay out of the crime scene so that they don't contaminate it, but they're able to gather what information they can and put their stories together, and they do newspaper and TV reports from the scene. And then we follow that up with a trial. And unlike lots of mock trials that historically have been done, this one is based on the actual event, the police reports that the police officers write, and the student lawyers call their student classmate police officers to testify as the witnesses. And we also have lots of great volunteers, especially with the State Highway Patrol, who's one of our very valuable co-sponsors statewide. We've got a couple of police officers that just go around and they play the role of the defendant and eyewitnesses, and not just on the scene, but then they come to the trial and testify as well.
I think this is really an interesting program. And in fact, I have to be honest with you, full acknowledgement of my knowledge about this program. Actually, I was contacted by, I think, a, teacher at North Technical High School.
Yes.
This was a couple years ago, Clarence Hines. In fact, those pictures were from his class. He called and asked if I would come out and coach some of his students. And I agreed to it. And then we had breaking news, so I couldn't go. So I was familiar with the program, and I just thought it was so incredible, and it was so neat. And what a great opportunity that these students have. And that's a great way, I think, Ms. Bertelson, for kids to learn with that hands-on experience, if you will.
Absolutely. And we have more than 40 judges in St. Louis County, and all of them are prepared and delighted to go out and talk to students. And they get as much out of it as I think the students do. We also, I lead a lot of tours of our courthouse, but part of that tour includes sitting in on an actual trial or sitting in on a criminal arraignment. And I'll tell you what, once you take away the kids' cell phones, which is vital, mm-hmm. you have their full attention. And mm-hmm. most students, like most adults, have not been in a courtroom. I mean, you may be in a courtroom one time in your life. It's usually for something unpleasant. But when kids show up in the courtroom, you know, our judges will come down off the bench and talk to them to explain what's about to go on. We've had prosecutors come over and talk to the kids. You know, we can have up to 50 at a time. And kids are fascinated by what's going on. And they love the fact that it is so unlike what they see on TV. You know, there isn't a lot of screaming and yelling, usually. There are very compelling arguments. And, you know, the judge is not pounding her gavel or being Judge Judy at all. It's a very different, very formal kind of proceeding, but it is fascinating. Our courts are open to the public at all times, unless it's a juvenile matter, and those mm-hmm. are closed to the public. Mm-hmm. But the public is always welcome, and any school district that's out there is welcome to come. I'll take you on a tour. We'll have our judges talk to kids. We can have question and answer sessions, but we're eager to let kids know what's going on to make them better informed citizens. And so when they get older, they understand the process, and they might, you know, there's a lot of distrust of public institutions in America right now for a number of reasons. I used to be a journalist too, so I think journalists mm-hmm. have a role to play in mm-hmm. that. But, you know, once you see how the process works, something clicks. And it's, because it's so different from TV, it's a really valuable way to spend a class afternoon. So,
and you are a journalist, and you mentioned that fact. So tell us about the role that journalists play in the judicial system, because we do play a role.
Sure. You know, journalists, as I said, I was one for 30 years, but you go to the court and you try to get all the facts that you can. You try to talk to the judge. So the judge usually says no, because I can't talk to you about mm-hmm. this case that's pending before me. Then you go to either side and try to get some information there. But journalists, unfortunately, are limited, you know, have limited access. Mm-hmm. They can't get all the information right. they would like to have.
Right.
And we always want more.
Right.
Journalists always want more. They want to tell the fullest story they can and provide the greatest amount of context. But they're only allowed a snapshot of it. And they're working under tremendous time pressure. So they have to get their story done as quickly as they can. That's part of my role, is to help journalists get the information they need in a timely fashion. So, but journalists have a snapshot. It's not the complete picture.
Right.
And it's hard to get that complete picture
Absolutely.
When you're on a deadline in
Absolutely.
Particular.
And to be honest, even when, say for example, a case comes to trial, you still don't get all of the information. You still don't get the full story.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you get what is presented in court, but there's
right.
still so much information that never comes to court
right.
that we don't get.
Right.
So I think you're absolutely right. And I think the onus is on us to be as responsible as possible as journalists in our fact finding, and to make sure we get the information right.
Yes.
And then when we don't get it right, we have to stand up and own that and say, hey, we made a mistake. This is what happened.
Sure. And it's a journalist's obligation to ask for the information.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's my obligation to say, no, I can't provide you that information. But
right.
I would encourage journalists to keep asking,
sure.
even if I can't give them exactly
Absolutely.
What they want. I'll give them as much as I can, and I'll explain why I can't if I can't.
Right. So Judge Page, just fill me in. Are you surprised by the reaction from the students? I mean, do they ask a lot of questions when these sessions are over, and like, just to expand their knowledge about the process?
I think We received an email today from the teacher who basically told us, oh, the kids would have liked to have asked more questions. Mm-hmm. We have to be really careful because I think they want to ask questions about the case we just heard. Right. So we have to be very careful about, and it's not that we don't want to tell you what we know, it's we can't. Right. We're ethically obligated not to discuss the cases that are pending before us. And so, but I do think that things like what Christie's doing in the St. Louis County Courts and what Doug is doing with the Constitution Project, it gets these students involved and really developing an understanding of what happens in a court from the journalist perspective, from the law enforcement perspective, and so they're getting a big picture. But in the most important thing about the Constitution Project is it brings the Constitution into your real everyday life. And I'd really like for you to talk a little bit, you're a master at doing that, and I would really like for you to talk about how you bring the Constitution alive, because it's the components are all important, but the ultimate benefit or the ultimate,
You're saying it better than I can.
Well, I'm not saying it very well, so I doubt that.
No, that's right, and that's the idea is, many things we're trying to accomplish. We want them to have a great experience and get a lot of experience. We want them to interact with mentors like yourself, which is such a valuable thing for these kids, and to get a vision for their future as well. But along the way, they are learning the Constitution many times without even realizing they are. Because, for example, when they realize they need a search warrant for this videotape that was in the security camera on their crime scene, then they figure out how to do those things and don't even realize until after the fact that they've gotten a master's level education in what the Constitution really prescribes and how it works. And so that's an exciting thing, and what we hope is that they understand that that's the way they stay free to become what they're meant to be. And that's really the biggest thing that we're all about, all of us. But definitely in this committee work that we do and as judges, we want to really impart that to these kids, that you have a special purpose in this life, mm-hmm. and this country keeps you free to become that. The Constitution is the way that you're kept free to become that, and all these things work together, including just what you were talking about. And so when we do that, then everybody winds up hopefully becoming what they're meant to in life and having a good experience along the way.
I think that's important that you said that, and I want to talk a little bit more about that after the break. Stay with us. We are back in a moment. Welcome back to the Pulse of St. Louis. Tonight we're talking about the judicial process and how it works. And Judge Gaston, you were talking about the importance of the kids understanding the Constitution, which I think is huge, because you know what your rights are. You know what you can and can't do. You know what can and cannot be done to you within the purview of the law under the Constitution. When we talk with kids, especially as it relates to, you gave an example of warrants, securing warrants to get video from a camera as well. And so my first thought was thinking, okay, what about when kids are out, and we see these cases sometimes, and a police officer, kids may be doing something, and I'm not even gonna give an example what they may be doing, but the police may say, hey, let me search your car. They pulled you over for a broken taillight, but let me search your car. The driver, whether it is a student or an adult, doesn't have to give the police officer permission to search the vehicle without a warrant, correct?
Well, that
or no?
That well may be correct. we're never to give, you know, advisory opinions based on hypotheticals.
No, I'm not saying advisory. I'm not saying advisory, but I'm just saying within the purview of the Constitution, I think it's important that we all, as Americans, we know what our rights are.
Absolutely, and you're making a great point, and it goes well beyond that, if I could just say, you know,
sure.
we always start the program every year with the question to these kids, where do your rights come from? Mm-hmm. And they think that, you know, I want to hear them say the Constitution because it's the Constitution Project, but that's not true. Mm-hmm. The founder said that you're born with certain rights. The Constitution is the way that those rights are protected. And so that's why it's so important and why this old document that hangs on a wall is not that at all. It really lives and breathes, and it has everyday application in your life. And the only way that you stay free is if this Constitution is sacred to you, young people. And so this is why we celebrate it. This is why we work with it and impart this knowledge to you, that now it's your turn to go forward. And when you become adults in whatever profession, just make sure that you uphold that and honor it.
But one of the things that's so cool about the Constitution Project that Judge Gaston really built from the ground up is that it's a very hands-on process for the schools and students that are lucky enough to be selected to participate in that. But it's all based on, as you said, Shirley, on constitutional principles. So for example, you know, search and seizure laws or due process issues, or, you know, those are the principles that the Constitution Project ultimately teaches. And because it's a hands-on project, they'll never forget the experience. Mm-hmm. It helps build wonderful, informed, intelligent citizens that will take their understanding of their, not just their responsibilities as citizens in a free society, but their understanding of our rights. And it's just a beautiful project. We just encourage every school in the state to apply to yes. to participate in this. We can only accommodate how many, Doug?
This year we're doing 12. We're hoping to expand that quite a bit next year, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we want very much to expand.
Right. So, Ms. Bertelson, just give me a sense of how do people get involved? And these are students and schools from throughout the state, not just in the St. Louis
right.
area. Okay.
I'm the chairperson of a subcommittee on public outreach for the Civic Ed Committee. And there's a set group of presentations that are available on the Supreme Court website that can be downloaded. But if there's a school district in any part of the state or a civic organization or a community group that wants to have a presentation, that wants to have a judge from their area or from another area, come and talk to them. I can put them in touch with a person in their part of the state who can make sure that the judge is there, who can make the presentation available, who can get any instructional materials that accompany the presentation, get those out ahead of time. So really, we've got the whole state covered. So that anyone, any citizen, any or non-citizen, any mm-hmm. part of the state who wants to hear from a judge or learn more about the law or the Constitution can contact the Public Outreach Committee or the Civic Ed Committee and get a presentation set up in their part of the
mm-hmm.
state.
Mm-hmm. I think it is such a fascinating program, both of them. I just think they're amazing. Judge Page, do you find after these programs end that students are saying, oh, I want to be a judge or I want to be a lawyer? Do you hear them saying they want to participate in the process?
Well, particularly with the Constitution Project, I want to be in law enforcement. I want to be in journalism. Mm-hmm. I had one young lady who was just a standout at the Supreme Court closing ceremony, not this past year, but the year before, who came up to me with tears pouring down her face because this program had meant so much to her that she took early graduation
wow.
and she was joining the military because of what the Constitution had come to mean to her. And I had never met this young lady in my life, but it was like, I'm getting goosebumps just remembering her. And I think that what it does is Judge Gaston instills a true love of the Constitution. And he's going to be mad at me for pointing this out, but I don't care. It's fabulous. He does this Constitution cheer where the kids from all across the state of Missouri mm-hmm. have their arms wrapped around each other. It's on the website.
Oh,
you
I think
see
I see
it.
That. Hey, guys, if we've got that picture, put that up. I think I saw that. And I was wondering what was going on. That's awesome.
So, but
yes.
this and every yes. time you see it, I never uh-huh. get tired. And every time he opens it up with a Constitution cheer or chant, and he closes it, and the kids are just, I mean, they're so excited about the Constitution.
Yes.
Think about that. We cheer for
right.
football teams and
right.
sports and
yeah.
you know, rock and roll bands and everything else. We yeah. got kids cheering for the Constitution.
Woo-hoo.
That's pretty, that's
I think
pretty
that's,
cool.
That's awesome. Gaston. So come on, Judge Gaston. So what's the cheer? You don't have to
so
do it.
So you have
what
to do it with
yet?
Me if we do
okay.
it. Though.
Well, yes.
So I
absolutely.
Might say something like, truth, and you would have to say
truth,
justice,
freedom,
and then we would carry on like right. that for a while. But that's the tagline
yes.
for our project, because
right.
if you find truth through journalism, through law enforcement, through trial advocacy, then there will be justice, and if there's justice, there will be freedom. So
yeah.
we're getting them to celebrate all those things.
Right. So how did the idea come to you to start this program?
Very truthfully, a school group that had come in about the fifth one of the day to my courthouse, and I always try to visit with them afterwards, try to inspire them a little bit, and ask them what they wanted to do when they got out of school. And I kept getting all these kids that were saying, I want to be a forensic pathologist or a crime scene investigator. And I finally realized they're watching these CSI shows,
mm-hmm.
and that's where they are. So why don't we meet them where they are and make this relevant to them and exciting for them? And just brought some of my local police officers in and a newspaper editor I knew and said, what do you think about this idea? And it's just, thankfully, it's grown since then.
It's amazing. So tell me, how much has it grown? And tell me, when did it first start, and then where we are now?
We started the first year in my hometown, I guess, was 2011.
Your hometown?
Houston, Missouri.
Houston, Missouri.
Yes.
Okay.
And within about a year and a half, I guess, we made it a statewide project through the Civic Education Committee, through Judge Breckenridge and the committee's leadership. And it actually has grown every year, and we've had more and more interest. But as Ted was alluding, we are limited by certain things, you know, as far as how many we can accommodate right now, but we're looking to expand that going forward. And we've got other states that want to do it, and a lot of interest out there.
That's awesome. Well, thank you for what we do, what you do, not what we do. I got to take a break, back in a moment. Welcome back to the Pulse of St. Louis. Tonight we're talking about some incredible programs that help teach our students about the judicial system and how it works. And Judge House, just give me a sense of how rewarding is this for you to know that you're really making a difference in the lives of our students. We always pay homage to our teachers, and rightly so, because they do an amazing job. But to know that, in a sense, we're all teachers too. We're helping too.
Ooh, that's so true. Well, I served in the Missouri Senate, and I can tell you, I mean, I supported public education because I feel that that's fundamental to our democracy mm-hmm. as well. Just being a judge is a great privilege and responsibility, and has a lot of adds a lot of purpose and meaning, you know, to your life. But the ability to go out into schools and churches and civic organizations, Rotary Club, you know, you name it, across the community, it's a very cool thing, because a lot of folks, again, they think of judges as being remote and distant and isolated, and our message here today, Shirley, is a judge in the state of Missouri wants to come to your class, and we'll make that happen. A judge wants to come to your civic organization, whether you meet at noon or breakfast or whenever. You know, a judge wants to come to your church and talks to your group or to your synagogue or whatever civic organization you've got, neighborhood groups that meet. We want to get out there and do that, but we want people to know about that. So we're grateful to you for the opportunity to share that, because a lot of people aren't aware that judges want to get out in the community and do that. So, and to answer your question, I mean, it's always fun. It's always rewarding, because we don't get to have much of a give and take dialogue with the public when we're in court. Right. That's a different process. That we've got very strict rules and rules of evidence and protocol and procedure and ethics, and, you know, I mean, that's a whole different environment. But when we can get out to the Rotary Club or get out to the high school or college or fourth grade class and help talk about the vital role of the judiciary in our democracy and how it works, I'm like Judge Page. I get goosebumps you know, doing that, and it's always a good thing.
Yeah. Got to take a break. Hold that thought, Judge Page. Got to take a break. Final thoughts are up next. Welcome back. Time now for final thoughts. Judge House, how about if we start with you, sir, your final thoughts?
Shirley, thank you so much. We want to get judges out into the community, and just encourage folks listening to us to contact the Supreme Court Civic Education Committee. I know you're going to share that information and on how to do that, and request that a judge come. You can review the presentations. You can even select the presentation from a menu that you want us to give, if it's a search and seizure issue or a free speech issue or something like that. So just encourage everybody to invite us. Please invite us to come to your class or your civic group. We want to be there, and we want to engage in that dialogue.
Awesome. Thank you, sir. Judge Gaston, final thoughts.
One thing we try to do always in our programs is involve the military and veterans. Nice. And amongst other messages that have been conveyed through the veterans, we have one who told the story to our kids that he had lost a friend of his in battle. And he told these kids, because of him and his sacrifice, you're able to become what you're meant to be. And that imposes a duty on you to become what you're meant to be in this life because of his sacrifice and the sacrifice of so many others. And so I think that's a really important message, and we want to do this because we feel like it's a duty and a privilege that we get as judges to get out and encourage and inspire kids to become what they're meant to be and to appreciate the country that allows them to become that.
Awesome, good point. Ms. Bertelson, final thoughts, ma'am.
I would echo what Judge House said, that the judges are eager to get out into the community and talk to groups. But since Halloween's coming up, it's a little bit like a vampire. You have to be invited in. Mm-hmm. You have to be invited before you can come in. Mm-hmm. But I also want to get the message out that the courts are open throughout the state, and the public should really take the opportunity to go and observe your local courts, You can talk to a judge, a prosecutor, a public defender, but it's a great learning opportunity and a great reminder of the importance of our justice system and the fairness of our justice system. And it's very impressive, and it should be part of every citizen's duty to come and do it. Not just on jury duty,
right,
but come and observe a trial.
Good point. Judge Page, final thoughts, ma'am.
Well, it's a tough act to follow with these three, I'll tell you, but I would say freedom's not free. And everything that they've talked about is the valuable lessons of what we need to do to protect our freedoms and the work that the courts do to do that, and that they're open and we want people to come in and learn about it. And anything that we can do to facilitate their education and to help them understand what happens in a courtroom, we are very happy and excited to do.
Well, thank you all so much for being here. I appreciate it, and thank you for what you do to help shape and mold our young people in our communities. Thank you. And thank you for joining us for The Pulse of St. Louis. Remember, if you missed any part of the show, download The Pulse of St. Louis podcast in the iTunes or Google Play stores. And remember, for news 24/7, download the News 11 app. And for news during the week, be sure to watch News 11 at noon, 4, and 7. I'll see you next time.